Life's Essential 8 is the AHA's checklist of 8 key measures for improving and maintaining cardiovascular health. The most recent addition to this checklist is sleep. Getting enough sleep is an important factor in lowering the risk for heart disease, stroke, and other major health problems. New research supports a link between sleep disorders, disturbed sleep, and adverse brain health, with potential impacts including stroke, the development of Alzheimer's disease, and Alzheimer's disease-related dementias. So what should you know about sleep to support the health of your brain? Hello, and welcome to House Calls. I'm Dr. Eduardo Sanchez, Chief Medical Officer for Prevention at the American Heart Association. Good sleep can boost your creativity and energy, as well as improve your mood and general brain function, including alertness, decision-making, focus, learning, memory, reasoning, and problem solving. On the other hand, poor sleep not only negatively affects brain function, but it can also put you at higher risk for brain-related diseases such as Alzheimer's disease, cognitive decline and dementia, depression and anxiety, and memory issues. That's why researchers have been taking a close look at the impact of sleep disorders on brain health. Sleep disorders are conditions that affect the quality, timing, and amount of sleep. Sleep disorders include sleep apnea, insomnia, sleep fragmentation, circadian rhythm disorders, and extreme sleep duration. All of these sleep disorders have been associated with adverse brain health. Here to talk with us about the effect of sleep on brain health is Dr. Rebecca Gottesman, Chief of the Stroke Branch at the National Institute of Neurological Disorders and Stroke Intramural Research Program. Dr. Gottesman, welcome to House Calls.
Thank you for having me.
Can you share a bit about your background? You recently were the lead author on a statement from the American Heart Association on the impact of sleep disorders and disturbed sleep on brain health. So are you a stroke expert or a sleep expert?
I'm a stroke neurologist, and I think a lot about sleep because I think a lot about how stroke and risk factors for stroke affect risk of dementia and cognitive decline. And sleep is one of those important risk factors that we really need to think about as we think about modifiable risk factors for stroke and dementia.
Can you explain how sleep affects our brain function?
So sleep is really something important. We obviously all do it, and we all wish we probably did more of it. Sleep is really when we consolidate what we've learned over the course of the day. So you process different things, you experience different exposures, you meet different people, and during sleep, it's our body's job to convert those day-to-day interactions to memories. And this is why sleep is really important, and if we think about how sleep changes over the life course, as people get older, their quality of their sleep gets worse. And we know that as people get older, their memory tends to get worse, at least in some proportion of people. So it's possible that this is really an important way to think about how sleep plays a restorative role in helping us preserve our memory. In addition, we think there's something that really is a cleanup system of some of the toxins in the brain that may accumulate and cause problems over time. So this is one of the key ways that sleep may be related to things like dementia and even Alzheimer's disease. There's something called the glymphatic system, and this is a sort of new concept that's been described recently, which basically has the function of clearing out these toxins. And when people have sleep problems, their glymphatic function may not be as good. They may not clear those toxins as well, which means that those toxins could accumulate and over time could even lead to something like Alzheimer's disease.
So what would you say to a patient who's been sleeping poorly and comes to you worried about developing Alzheimer's disease?
So in general, we know from observational studies, so what this means, people who have been studied over time, but we didn't intervene with their sleep. So we observed how much sleep they got. We observed if they had something like sleep apnea or sleep disordered breathing. We observed different characteristics of their sleep. And we know from observational studies that people with those abnormalities and disorders and disturbances of sleep can have a higher rate of stroke, a higher rate of dementia, and a higher rate of Alzheimer's disease. In addition, we know that people who have dementia or Alzheimer's disease are at a higher risk for having sleep problems. And some of that is because they're not in a familiar environment for people that have to be in a care facility, for example. So even though there's pretty good evidence that sleep disorders and sleep disturbances are associated with dementia and Alzheimer's disease, and that people who have dementia and Alzheimer's disease have a greater risk of sleep disorders, we don't fully understand if one causes the other, but we clearly see that there's a link between the two disorders.
So we generally think of dementia and Alzheimer's disease as conditions that affect older folks, though we know that they can also affect people at younger ages. Can you talk about other conditions that might affect anyone who's experiencing poor sleep?
So certainly people who have poor sleep often can have other comorbidities such as depression or anxiety. The reality is that hasn't been as well studied as you might think. We know less about how depression and anxiety and other conditions may play a role leading to sleep problems, which could, and how that might affect cognitive decline. We do know that there's some evidence that people with depression may have worse cognitive performance, but again, that doesn't mean that it actually leads to dementia or cognitive disorders over time. So it is highly likely that there's an interaction between the two, that people who have depression and anxiety may have worse sleep. The combination may make their cognition that much worse, but we don't fully understand how those interplay with each other.
Well, let's talk about good sleep. How much sleep should people aim for?
The AHA itself has mentioned that sleep is such an important part of ideal cardiovascular health that it's now part of the life's essential eight, is ideal sleep or optimal sleep. And what they recommend is consistent with what other bodies have recommended, which is about 7 to 9 hours of sleep for an adult. For older adults, it looks like probably 7 to 8 hours is sufficient. Those are obviously very similar numbers. And the reality is different people have different amounts that work for them. But in general, we see some evidence that people that get regularly too little sleep or too much sleep may have higher risk of some of these outcomes that we talked about earlier.
I think most people have a sense that they don't get enough sleep, but let's give folks an incentive to get more sleep. What does good sleep make possible?
So as I mentioned, high quality sleep and spending enough time in that slow wave sleep is really important for really compiling all the information you've learned over the course of the day, consolidating those memories, and doing that sort of cleaning up to make sure that all these connections your brain has made over the course of the day are there and are kept, but that you're fresh to do that again the next day. So people that don't get high enough quality sleep may not remember things as well that they learned over the course of the day. And certainly in general, we know that people that have less high quality sleep, their attention span may be short. They may be more forgetful and not be able to do things even on a short term. In general, we've been talking about long-term consequences of sleep disorders, but in the short term, a night of poor sleep can certainly affect your function, the speed of your, you know, your reaction time, your reflexes, things like that.
So if I don't sleep very well one night, can I just take a nap and make it up on the weekend?
So you may feel better. It's not likely to really improve your sleep and the effect it has on your brain and your function. So certainly naps are a good thing for some people. And there's some people in recovery from some diseases. So after stroke, for example, people often need more sleep and may need that restorative additional sleep, such as from a nap. But in general, you can't really play catch up if you've not gotten enough sleep on a given night.
Another thing people may be wondering about are over-the-counter remedies for insomnia or poor sleep. Can these options like melatonin and magnesium help people get better sleep?
So in general, things like melatonin and other vitamins tend to be harmless in that we don't think they worsen anything. Certainly for some people, when your circadian rhythm, so circadian rhythm is basically your body knowing when you should be asleep and when you should be awake. So the classic example is people who are jet lagged, and their body thinks they're in a different time zone than they are, and they're not able to sleep when they should. So that's sort of a typical type of circadian rhythm disruption. Some people have more chronic circadian rhythm disruptions that really do benefit from melatonin, for example. If you change what you're talking about in terms of medications, and not just over-the-counter meds, but think about sleep medications, so sleep drugs that are prescribed by a doctor to help people sleep, there is no evidence that they help for any of these long-term sequelae of sleep, and there's even some evidence that some of these medications are associated with the higher risk themselves of dementia. So we really want people to be cautious and talk to your doctor, obviously talk about your individual risks, why you might need these medications before you decide to go on any of those sleep aids.
Well, that's good to know. So you were the lead author on a recent statement from the American Heart Association about the connections between sleep disorders and brain health. Can you share the major takeaways from the statement?
Sure. So in this statement, we really emphasize the nature of the problem. We talk about how sleep and sleep disorders and sleep disturbances are related to strokes, related to stroke-like changes in the brain that don't actually cause stroke symptoms, sort of silent strokes, cognitive decline and dementia, as well as Alzheimer's disease. We talk about the mechanisms, what we think is happening at a biological level to link these things together. But I think a really important area that we haven't touched on is what can we do about it in the population at large to reduce some of these long-term sequelae of sleep problems. And there's a lot of exciting studies being done, but really we're at the very beginning of understanding what we can do to prevent and treat sleep disorders if they're there. medications are not the best way to improve sleep disturbances if we want to improve risk for dementia and cognitive decline. But there's some evidence that people who have sleep apnea and have cognitive decline and wear CPAP, continuous positive airway pressure, with the mask that you wear at night, have better cognitive outcomes than people who don't. There's a couple of exciting studies being done in the stroke world. We know people that have sleep apnea after stroke more frequently have poor recovery from their stroke. And so these trials are looking at the use of CPAP to see if that improves post-stroke recovery in people with a stroke who have sleep apnea that's diagnosed afterwards. So I think this is going to be a really important area for us to understand more about. The most important lesson here is, if you think you have a sleep disorder, talk to your doctor, get a sleep study. It's amazing how many people think, well, it's just what I should expect with my age. I'm not supposed to be sleeping as well. If you have a partner who is snoring loudly or seems to be occasionally not breathing during sleep, certainly you should encourage them to get tested with a sleep study. Sleep studies are pretty easy to do, and they give us a lot of useful information. And like I said, we have lots of evidence, not just on the brain side of things, but in health in general, that CPAP for sleep apnea really can be effective if worn as prescribed. So really, I would advise people to talk to your doctor and see if you might be someone who needs a sleep study.
This conversation has really made clear the importance of getting good sleep. Can you share some tips on what we can do on a daily basis to get better sleep?
You know, one of the really important things I think to think about is to avoid screens right before you go to bed. This is something that has been shown to be associated with better sleep hygiene, is what we call it, in terms of what are the behaviors that you can do to improve your sleep. For some people, caffeine after noon, after 3 p.m. is really problematic with keeping them up at night. So really trying to avoid caffeinated beverages in the afternoon and certainly in the evening to help with your sleep hygiene. And in general, you know, different people find that exercise at different times of the day might help them, but exercise at some point seems to be beneficial for allowing you to sleep well at night. So for some people, it's first thing in the morning. Some people prefer to do it later in the day, but the actual activity of exerting energy and doing exercise is probably good for your sleep hygiene in general.
Well, that's great information. Dr. Gottesman, thank you so much for talking with us about the importance of sleep to brain health, and thank you for being with us on House Calls. Let's recap some key takeaways. Getting enough sleep is an important factor in lowering the risk for heart disease, stroke, and other major health problems. Research suggests that poor sleep can put you at risk for stroke and the development of Alzheimer's disease. Adults should aim for 7 to 9 hours of sleep a night. Avoiding screens before bed, limiting caffeine afternoon, and exercising can all help you get better sleep. And finally, if you've been struggling to sleep or you think you might have a sleep disorder, talk to your doctor. If you have questions about health conditions, I'd love to hear from you. Comment below, hit subscribe, join me here next time for answers you can trust.